So while doing set theory in algebra, all of us knows that the playing objects are going to be sets. So from one set to another set, we move through the connections called functions. So functions will take one object to another object. That is the transition mode from one object to another object in set theory. Moreover, these functions allow us to say which kind of objects, which kind of sets are looking alike. For example, if you have two sets A and B, from A to B you have a function here, which is both one to one and on to. I mean, the bijection exists. What you observe from our set theory course is they are looking alike. They are equivalent. Set theoretically there is no difference. You can differentiate two sets whenever they are having in bijection. They are getting a bijection in between. So it's just a relevant. So this these are notable things, not only in set theory, in any branch of mathematics. Always you have to play a collection of objects. And from in between objects you have a transition mode or a connection mode. Usually we call that they are morphisms in the IP language. And it allows us later to say when two objects are alike or equivalent. So these fundamental facts are the characteristic for any branch of mathematics. Suppose we are going a little bit further, for example group theory, then definitely our objects will change, not mere sets but now groups. A group G, whenever we are calling as a group G, it's also equipped with a binary operation. So two objects in this group theory, if you are looking at, certainly a function may not give the full picture or structure of this inbuilt things. So our connections or morphisms in group theory, we must definitely take care of homomorphisms. Homomorphism, we know that they preserve the structure of the group. Obviously, isomorphic objects give the equivalence. That is a bijection, which is forward and backward journey are also giving us homomorphism. Obviously, you are going to get equivalent objects. So again, these fundamental facts are revisited. Playing objects, morphisms, and equivalences. So in such a way, we can approach any branch of mathematics. It will give a very universal way of studying. You have experienced the analysis course or geometry course on Euclidean structures, for example, plane or three-dimensional space, or even with real line. In, for example, you take plane. In the plane, there is already an equipped nice distance concept. So Euclidean distance is available. So using Euclidean distance, just very fundamental in geometry, Euclidean geometry. So if you are considering the study of geometry, the branch of geometry in Euclidean spaces, for example R2, again I am specifying, then maybe your objects are planar things like circles, triangles or rectangles. So from one geometrical object to another geometrical object, if you want to move, even these simple functions are not enough. You have to consider the distance concept along with, because already Euclidean concept. From one triangle to another triangle, if you are moving to a function, a bijection definitely will give the transition, say theoretically, but that is not enough. Structure is more relying on the distance concept. So a distance preserving functions are more applicable, or which will give more intrinsic picture of geometry. So in that case, whenever you are considering Euclidean geometry, the geometrical figures to geometrical figures, if you want to move in the Euclidean way, you have to consider distance preserving functions. So equivalence obviously gives you distance preserving max, which are going to be isometries, usually used to call. Distance preserving max are called isometries in more general setup itself, even in metric spaces also. All Euclidean spaces are metric spaces. So once again, equivalence is given through isometries from both words, which means congruences we use. Certain equivalents are given by congruences, by injections, surface distances, both sides. So congruent figures are looking alike in geometry. But this kind of study will allow us to get a unified manner, as I mentioned before. In such a way, if you are looking at the topological aspects of even Euclidean spaces, we have observed a lot of things. In the sense that, plane you, for example, you are taking, just take a triangle or a rubber band, the replica of a rubber band, which is an ellipse, a elliptical shape. This ellipse, I can just deform it to a rectangle, or I can just deform without breaking as into a triangle. So from one ellipse shape, if I am moving to a rectangle shape, formally I am trying to define a function, which may be 1, 1, and 2. Even without break, I am moving, means it's the notion of continuity. So bijective continuous maps are defining in these deformations. There are a lot of properties which are preserved under these continuous maps. So in this case, see, for example, a triangle to another triangle, if it is distance preserving, definitely that we have some notions of geometric constraints. But if you are looking on a topological concept, for example, elliptical figure you have, you are deforming it to be a rectangular shape. Even the next step, if you are trying to define it to be a triangle, all these figures geometrically entirely different, we know. Distance are not at all concerned anywhere, the shapes are entirely defined. You are not going to get equivalent of this from the geometrical point of view at all. But this, from one figure to another figure, we are getting through continuous functions. It may be possible to define continuous functions to move from an ellipse to a rectangle, or a rectangle to a triangle also. But there are some intrinsic things which are not invariant. See, for example, an ellipse, if you are drawing on the plane, it divides the entire plane into three: the interior, the ellipse, as well as the outside. So these kind of properties are preserved well, but we know. Such properties are under the roof of topology. So that is the Euclidean picture we are discussing. What we are aiming at here, in a very abstract manner, that is not only from the Euclidean picture. Euclidean picture allows us to go for the metric spaces, what happen in general. From that metric spaces, we will just switch over to the more abstract sense. How will you define this kind of things? Formally, I mean notion of topological spaces as objects. Then how to define continuity very abstractly, and how these connections, which are the use the equivalences, we will call homeomorphisms later. This kind of things we will discuss it here. We have already observed some basic notions of topology while considering Euclidean spaces Rn. In Rn, we have the Euclidean or Pythagorean metric with us. This Pythagorean metric allows us to define how neighborhoods are. The notion of neighborhoods obviously give us openness as well as closeness of subsets of Rn, and hence topological properties also. To describe the topological properties, suppose A and B are subsets of Euclidean spaces. In that case, if you have a function f which is a continuous bijection and inversion is also going to be continuous, then f is going to be called as a homeomorphism. So homeomorphisms are going to keep the topological properties. Properties like connectedness, compactness, we have already discussed in the Euclidean spaces. So once you have a homeomorphism from one subset of Rn to another subset of Rn, topologically they are the same. See, for example, suppose we have three objects in R2 or R3 also, you can consider in R2, first figure is looking at an ellipse, second is a circle, and third one is a rectangle. Or one can just make it as a replica of a rubber band. From the first figure to the second, I can just make it a deformation. Without breaking, I can make a deformation to get the second figure, as well as second to third also I can make it, if I am working or using
vaguely with the rubber bands. Mathematically speaking, the first object to the second object, if I am moving, I'm trying to define a function which is a bijection, which is continuous. Without break, I'm doing that. And inversion is also going to be continuous. It says that I'm trying to get a homeomorphism from the first to second, as well as another function which is also going to be a homeomorphism from the second to the third. Then it says that all these three objects are going to be one and the same from the topological point of view. See, for example, connectedness are prevailing, it's preserved. Compactness is another property which is preserved. All figures will distinguish or disjointify the entire plane into two, inside, outside, and in fact, it's a curve also. So these kind of properties we are dealing under the proof of topology. Geometrically, all these figures are entirely different. See, the geometrical invariance like arc length or area bounded by these figures, all such things are different. So geometrically, they are entirely different. Geometrical equivalents are called congruences. Congruences is much finer than homeomorphisms. But homeomorphism may not give you congruences in general. See, what happens for the function from 0, 1 to 2, 4, if you are looking at f of x equals 2x plus 2, obviously it is a bijection, continuous, and the inverse is also going to be a continuous function. This simply says that you are working with a homeomorphism and you are getting 0, 1 is topologically equivalent with 2, 4. In fact, from 0 to 2, 4, 0, 1 to 2, 4 is just a stretching, an elongation. But geometrically, they are far away in the sense that 0, 1 is having unit length or 2, 4 is having of length 2. These kind of notions in the Euclidean spaces definitely allow us to look at topology in metric spaces. So in metric spaces, what happens is the following. If you are working in a metric space, for example, XD is a metric space, then formally one can define an open ball centered at a point x naught in x with radius r. By definition, one can make it all those x's in x for which the distance from x and x naught is less than r, strictly less than. So this set is called the open ball centered at x naught with radius r. Then we'll define what is an open subset of x. U is a subset of x. It is said to be an open subset provided every x in U, if you are able to find some ball taking that x and r. So this formal definition immediately gives us the following. All balls, all open balls are indeed open. More than that, any open set if you are taking, one can write it as the union of open balls. These two things are easily following from the general notions. Moreover, if you are working with the collection of open sets in this metric space, what you can observe as properties are the following. Phi as well as x, they are typical subsets of x, proper subsets of x. So on this xd, phi as well as x are going to be open. According to this notion, arbitrary union of open sets are again going to be open in x. And finite intersections of open sets in metric spaces are also going to be open. These three crucial properties, which actually allow us how to give a general abstraction for a topology. So that is our next thing. If you want to try to write abstraction of topology, it is as follows. Just take a non-empty set X. Now we'll call that a collection of subsets of X, which is a part of a power set. if it possesses the following or if it satisfies the following three fundamental axioms or properties. Sorry, property axioms. Empty set as well as X should be in our toe. Toe is going to be closed under arbitrary unions. Toe is closed under finite intersections. So these are the fundamental axioms what we need our toe should possess. If toe is such a collection of subsets of X, then X with this toe we'll call it topological space. That is our abstract definition of a topology.